Okay, so that was the title. So as I said, it's probably more biased than historical, and I will describe a few property or construction of paraphermionic observable. And the good thing is that Jörg is in the audience, so then he will correct me about the history, and you know, I'm sure he will make many comments.
Yes.
Any more mistakes?
Actually, there's a second correction. One should not view fermions or parafermions as observables.
Okay, parafermion.
The title you gave has field in it.
Right? Fields? Okay, better. But for me, an observable is a map from the space of configuration to some space. Then it works. Okay, so first, I will describe spins. These are the parafermionic fields. So I will describe the construction in a statistical model, in a lattice statistical model. And more or less what I will follow is a construction by Kadanoff and Seva. From the 70s. So maybe it's not the first construction of fermionic or parafermionic field in a statistical model. Before, there was the Jordan-Wigner construction was maybe the first, but I think this is the first which introduced parafermion. So what I want to describe, besides the construction of, and to explain what are the disorder on parafermionic field, I want to see the connection with the group symmetries. And for instance, one of the echoes of this construction is there will be the analog of the Gauss law that you all know in electromagnetism. There is a Gauss law which reflects some symmetries, and here there will be analog of the Gauss law in statistical models, which is linked to the existence of conserved currents. And I want to describe, to explain why these fields are called parafermions. They are called parafermions because they satisfy some breeding relations, some kind, in physics we call them commutation relations, which are more general than those for fermions or for bosons. So they satisfy some breeding relations. The breeding relation code what happens when you exchange, permute in some way these fields, observables. And that will be linked to what we call the Young-Baxter equation. So that's what I want to explain in this part. Then, so all this construction will be done on the lattice, so that will be, maybe the lattice can be infinite, the domain can be infinite, but there's not too much problem in defining the object. And then I will go to field theory, so some echoes in or descendant construction in field theory. I will jump a little bit on field theory without defining completely all the object I will deal with. And mostly what I want to describe first is the construction of the analog of parafermions in the case of U1, which is due to Mandelstam. which is called Mandelstam vertex operators. And that's also in the 70s, a bit later than Kadanoff and Seva. And that's what the point I want to make is the connection that comes from this construction is some property or some of objects which generalizes operators, which is called vertex also vertex operators, but in conformal field theory. So I want to explain. How in some way the vertex operators that appear in conformal field theory are in a way paraphermionic observable, and they satisfy, so the Breding relation will be related to the monodromy of the correlation function. And on this, I think the echo of this construction is a formulation of generalized vertex operator algebra, which include parafermionic algebra and more general infinite dimensional algebra, which generalize affine algebra. So there is a notion of vertex operator algebra. So the name associated to that, probably. So the name associated to Young-Baxter is Young and Baxter's. I forget to say. Which is in the 60s and so on. Here we can associate the name of Zamolchikov. And Fateyev, for instance. And they define what is called the ZN parafermionic algebras in conformal field theory. So which is just a generalization of the Z construction on the lattice of the so on the lattice you can define some parafermion associated to the group Zn, and if you push this construction to the continuum in field theory, you get an operator algebra, vertex operator algebra, which is related to the group Zn. And in math, maybe you can associate Frankel, Katz, Lepofsky, and so on. Which use vertex operators to find representation of Lie algebras and affine Lie algebras, and then which define a setup to discuss what are vertex operator algebras. So that's one first descent application construction in field theory of vertex operator algebra. Another echo is this is in conformal field theory, which is a field theory which is invariant by dilatation, conformal transformation, which has no scale. In massive theory, which is a field theory with scale, there is different echo of this construction. One is the notion of tau function on isomonodromy deformation. So that was used, for instance, by the group, the Kyoto group, to study, to compute and characterize correlation function in the massive Ising model, in the Ising model away from the critical temperature. So the name associated to that is Sato, Jimbo, Miwa. So that's in the 80s, probably. So that's what I will discuss. Without explain, I will just discuss how it's related to the parafermionic fields. I will not discuss how to construct this tau function, neither the vertex operator algebra. I will just discuss how it's related. Then the third point will be back on the lattice, where I will discuss relation between integrability and quantum symmetry and parafermionic fields. So I will discuss the relation between let's say Q group symmetries. So in the first part, as you will see, that parafermionic fields are related to group symmetry and linked via the Breiding relation to Young-Baxter equation. So the quantum groups are groups which are intimately related to the Young-Baxter equation. And any if you impose this quantum group symmetry, you produce models which are integrable. And you may wonder what are the consequences of these symmetries in the same way that in the first part, we will see that due to the symmetry, we have parafermionic field. So I will show what are the analog of the Gauss law on the conserved currents in the case of the quantum group symmetries. So and that will be linked to Smirnov's currents, parafermion. As well as the construction of Cardy and the computation of Cardy, which relate to the Smirnov parafermion to the integrability of the ON model at the critical point. That was done in the 90s, and that 2000 something. Okay. So first, space disorder of parafermions. So what we consider is a spin model on the lattice. So I will take the square lattice. Delta. So we have spin vibe. So on each side of the lattice, for E, a site on the lattice, we have spins. Let's say we call it S, which take a value somewhere. So it's I, which belongs to, I don't know, some set, discrete. And we will define the Boltzmann way by saying that there is a local interaction between the spins. So we give a local interaction. H of S, S prime. And the interaction will be between spins which are adjacent on the lattice and the Boltzmann weight for a configuration. So S. So the configuration is the data of the spin variable on each side of the lattice. We associate a Boltzmann weight, WS, which will be equal to exponential of minus SI, SJ, where IJ is a link on the lattice. So that's a link. So they are neighbor. So I, j are neighbor on the lattice. And the probability of a configuration is just the Boltzmann weight divided by the partition function. The partition function normalizes the probability measure. Okay? It's exactly like Hugo defined this morning for the Ising model, where the spin was taking two values, plus or minus. And we assume, so the property, the disorder operator on the parafermion will arise when there is a group symmetry in the model, which means that the interaction will be invariant under some group. So we assume group symmetry, which means that H so there is some group G, group which acts on the set of S on which the spin takes value. And we assume that so there is an action of the group on that set, and we assume that the Hamiltonian is invariant under this action. Is it clear? So that's so what I denote by G times S is the action of J on the set here. Okay? So for instance, G can be Z2, G can be, I don't know, SU2, E8, whatever. Okay? So that's defined a statistical model which is invariant under some group J. In the sense that probability of a configuration and the probability of another configuration, which is the second configuration obtained from the first one by the action of the group, are the same. Okay. So then the spin variable, so I should keep track of that. So what we call spin observable. And for me, an observable is a map from the configuration space to, I will take to some the real number. So it's a map, it's sigma, which is a map from S to the real number, which associates the value which take. So it depends on I. So for I on the lattice. And it picks the spin at the position I and assert to it a function which I call sigma I. Okay? So I just choose the I here. So that's I. And to that. And then that's a function on the on my configuration space. So it's a function on the space of event on which I define probability. So I can compute expectation of this function or of product of this function. And that's what we call correlation function. So I can compute so if I will denote them sigma, I pick n points, sigma 1, sigma I n. And that will be simply 1 over the partition function over all the spin configuration of W sigma of Si, S1, Si1, Si n. And this is partition function, so this is some normalization factor for the probability. Okay? So maybe you call it E. That's the same thing as E of sigma I1, sigma IN. Okay? And then you can choose to, and we will need that, we will So this will work for any function S on the space S, but we can select, or we can maybe decompose the space of function on functions which are covariant under the action of the group. So we select function sigma S which are covariant under the action of J. Which means that if we transform the function sigma of G minus 1 S, so this function, which is a new function, which is a function obtained by transform, which is a new function on the space of on the space on which spin takes value, which is a function transformed by the action of the group, it will become simply so this function may take value in some space, so it takes value in some space, vector space V, and vector space V carry a representation of the group, so this one will transform as where A relates to G, R of G, which belongs to the endomorphism of V, is a representation of G, okay? So the function is covariant under the action of the group. So this means that we will call such representation sigma R, so it's indexed by a representation. And then we can choose to look at the correlation function at all the spin variables. Okay? So for example, if it's if J is Zn, maybe I can give an example. G is Zn, the action S takes value on Zn2, and I can just multiply, that's define my action of the group, and I can label the representation by an integer, so I will have sigma k of Z, which is Sk, for k belongs to 1 to n, modulo n, okay? And if it's SU2, I take a spin take value in some representation of SU2, and I act by this value. So that corresponds to local observable. I just have representation, I insert the spin at some value here. Okay? So that's I1, I2, IN, I don't know, n minus 1. Okay, and I compute the endpoint correction function. I want to keep that. Okay, is it okay?
So in the case of easing model, for example, you don't get much choice, right?
No. G is SU2. So either you take the sigma is the identity or the just the action sigma is I send Z to Z, to S to S, okay? So that's the spin observable, so they are local observable on the lattice. And then, because there is group symmetry, you can define the disorder operators, which are non-local. So non-local. So the local spin observables are indexed by representation of the group. So the disorder operator, which I will call mu, are indexed by group element. G belongs to the group. And the local observables are indexed by a point on the lattice, a site. And this one will be indexed by gamma. And gamma is a contour on the dual lattice. oriented contour. So what it is? So I take a contour. So that will be gamma. And I oriented the contour counterclockwise. Okay. So the contours. So the contour will cross a number of links. Okay. So that, and to each link crossed by the contour, I will associate a weight, the formula. So if the contour cross a link from here to here, so the contour goes like that, and I call it S minus S plus, then mu of J of gamma will be the product over all the links crossed by gamma. So let's say belongs to gamma. Okay. And what I do is that I will I insert these factors, the Boltzmann weight, but the inverse of the Boltzmann weight, so the Hamiltonian with a plus, minus H so this means that every time I cross a link like that, I replace the Boltzmann factors by the Boltzmann factor where I twist the spins inside the loop by J. Okay? So this means that here when I was computing this correlation function here, I had to sum over all the configuration with the spin inserted over all the configuration. Now, so it means if I with a weight which involves the Boltzmann weight for each of the link crossed by gamma. So I change this weight just by shifting the spin which is here. Okay? And this one is transformed by J, this one is transformed by J. Okay? So that's the contour, okay? So that's the definition.
You just change it for the links which connect to the outside, to the other side of the contour. You don't change it for the inside.
I just change it on one side of the contour because it's invariant. So like if I were changing on both spins, it will do nothing.
But this S minus, isn't it?
It's all the contour. Huh? It's a product of all the links. So if I have many links, so I do it for one link, but that's a link crossed by, well, is a link cross by gamma. So all the links which I cross by gamma, I change the Boltzmann weight. Okay, so S plus S minus refer to the link if you want that one. It's associated to the link, and the link is, if this is a link, this is L minus, this is L plus, and if my orientation is such that gamma is in this direction. Okay? Is it clear?
So it's self-avoiding, or it can intersect itself? So what happens if it crosses several times the same edge? Do you allow that or not?
No, I will not. But probably you may, and then you will join the same.
I mean, a more stupid question. Is it for purpose that it is closed?
Yes, up to now, it's on purpose. Okay? So then I can compute, I can insert here. This correlation function, I can look at correlation function with many local spin variables and say one of the spins gamma. Okay? I can do that. This one is non-local. So this will correspond to this configuration. So I compute an expectation value where there is many spins a contour, some of the spins are inside, some of the spins are outside. Okay? And then the first property is that this is the same thing. There's not much to do as a correction function of the spins without the contour. But then you act so correction function with a disorder operator inserted is the same thing as the correction function without the disorder operator inserted, but you have to rotate all the spin variables. And you rotate according to which? To the representation which is associated to the sites. Okay? So that's a property. So I don't know. Since I am not a mathematician, I never write a theorem, but just property. So where does this follow? So when you compute such correlation function, you have to sum over all the Boltzmann weight, all the spin configuration with the Boltzmann weight, and with this variable inserted. But since the contour gamma, the disorder operator, inserts a defect all along the contour, you can renumber the spins inside the contour by S is renamed G minus inverse of G on S. Okay, that's you assume it's a bijection. So then you do the sum, and that will then you will undo the defect, but you will transform the spins. Okay.
So it's important as Hugo's question that the contour is not self-voiding.
Probably because
you need an inside and outside, right?
Yeah, but if I had many contours, then I would depend. If it's I will do for. That will correspond to two contour, gamma 1 and gamma 2.
That's an exercise. You should take the rotation number or something like that and act.
Right? Yeah. So I will be able to decompose on each of the connected components. So the effect of the contours is just to rotate the spin inside. Okay. So that's what we call in field theory, this is a wide identity. In field theory, that's what we call wide identity. And that's the same thing as the Gauss law. Because Gauss law, what does the Gauss law? It tells you that the flux of magnetic flux of something is equal to the charge. Flux inside the ball is equal to the charge inside the ball. Okay, so so that's exactly the same thing. So why? Because for instance, we can take take G Lie group, and that's also what I want to say. That's more or less the same thing as a Noether current, if you want, Noether theorem in physics. You know that in classical mechanics, every time you have a symmetry, then you have a conserved current, which is called a Noether current. So here we have a symmetry, and then we have an associated current in that case. So for that, to have a current, we have to consider a Lie group. Okay. So if the Lie group, we can look at group elements close to the identity. So we take J is equal to 1, the 1 in the group, plus epsilon X. X belongs to the Lie algebra of the group. Okay. And then when I do the expansion here, I will have something which will be close to the identity. Okay. So then in that case, mu of J of gamma will become something like 1, first time, plus something of order epsilon, which will be linear in X, okay, which will be a sum over all the link in gamma, something which I will call G star X associated to the link. Okay. Doesn't matter what is G star, it's just what you got from the expansion here. It's linear in X, and it's associated to the link. Okay? And then what this identity says is that, then that I want to give a name, def. I will call it integral over gamma, discrete one if you want, of G star of X. No, it's just it's a sum over the contour. Can call it integral of the contour. Well then, what this identity becomes to? So for G equal 1 plus epsilon gamma, so I expand that to first order in epsilon, this one to first order in epsilon, and then I got sigma I1, R1, Rn, integral of G of X on gamma. This is the same thing as the sum. When I expand that to first order in epsilon, I got the sum over all the sites ik, which is inside gamma, R of X, Rk of R on correlation function. Okay. So that goes slow. And this is the way we write usually the wide identities in field theory. The flux of what I will call J star is equal to the sum of the charges inside the domain, the surface. Well, that's an analog of the Noether currents. So it means that
to deduce this, you need a continuous group, a Lie group.
Yeah.
If G is plus minus one, like in the discretizing case.
So what you can do, so you have this statement here. But nevertheless, what you can do when it's discrete is that you can see that you can deform the contour. So here, you can see that you can deform the contour. And there is no obstruction to deform the contour, as long as there is no topological obstruction in the sense that you don't cross a spin. Okay? So that's true for any group element. Okay? So remember that. Here, what you see is that when there is a Lie group, you can deform the contour. So this form is closed, actually. Okay? So away from charges or spins, G star J of X is equal to zero. That's what we call a conservation law, okay? So it's a flat curvature is zero if you think that this is a connection. So here you have the same thing. You transport. You can view as mu of G of transporting a connection along gamma, and this connection is flat, you can deform it, okay? And that's true for also for discrete case. And that will be true for quantum groups too. Okay? Is it clear?
What you're saying is that your contour cannot cross the spin, the I1, I2,
I? No, the contour is on the dual lattice, so it never crosses. The contour is on the dual lattice, from the middle of the face to the middle of the face, on the spin around the vertex. Okay? Okay, so now parafermions. So they are non-local. Are just, so I call it psi, G, R, and I. So they are indexed by a group element, J, belongs to J. This is the representation of J in some vector space in V. And that one takes value in V. And I is a lattice site. Okay? And it's just defined by sending one of the contour to infinity. Sorry about that. Otherwise, it will depend on 2 points on the finite lattice. So I take I. So that's I. And that is a representation associated to it. And then, which color I choose? No. Was orange. And then I have a J here, okay? That's my disorder operator. I will put it until here, okay? J. And this one will go to infinity. So you may choose infinity to be one of the points on the boundary if you have a boundary, okay? And then, from what I said before, as long as you don't have insertion of other operator, you can move this string as you want.
So the J was the contour?
No, J is an element of the group. So you have, you put a defect here, it means that you change the Boltzmann weight, and you insert a spin here. And this, attached to that, there is a representation.
So this is like taking a contour that is actually just a path.
Yeah, exactly. And the infinity is a point on the boundary. And for physics, it's far away. Okay. And then that string, you can, if there is no insertion here on the lattice, you can move it from what we said before. So it's a flat connection. Okay, so that's a parafermion. Okay, so it's exactly as from Hugo's lecture this morning. This was the analog of the winding numbers and so on that he introduced, but it was for Zn, or for not Zn exactly. Okay, so the point I want to explain now is why they are called parafermions, and the fact that they are parafermions is that they satisfy some Breeding relation, which means I want to take the product to compute some correlation function where there is two parafermions inserted on the lattice. Okay. Imagine I want to compute some correlation function where there is this operator inserted. And then you can, first, before doing that, you can try to say what are the what happens if I want to compute, how we have it here. So let me, maybe something simpler, I want to compute some correlation function where I insert sigma on my lattice. Okay. So then I have, that will be I1. And imagine I put I2 on the same line. Okay, that's I1 and I2. Okay. No, that's I2. Somewhere I don't have a problem on I1. Okay? So I have two spin observable inserted at this position I1 and I2, which are on the same line. And then I have to introduce my disorder operator J. And then I have two possibilities. Either I do that, or I do that. Okay? So before, they were the same, because I can move it, but now they are not a priori the same because there is a topological obstruction to move the strings. Okay, so that I will call sigma 2 and then parafermion because I define by convention that this is the order direction in which I order the observables, where this one will be sigma times psi because this is first psi and then sigma. Okay. Now I do same thing for this product. So this product, I will have I1, G1, I1, then I have I2, R2. And then here I do first, I will do the opposite. I will do first one. Which one I want to do?
Is it possible to explain how the end of the path is restricted? I mean, does it have to be in the box next to
what?
I? How is the end of the path restricted?
You have the freedom to put here or here or here or here. You have freedom. For the Ising model, you can do both. And that will define four fermions, which will be the four fermions that you have.
But changing the end of the path does change.
A bit. Yeah. So if I do that, I first act with a parafermion number one and then with a parafermion number two, which means that the second string, which is G2, act after one. Okay? And then I can move it as I want upstairs. Okay? But now this string, I can move it, so I can write it as okay. And then I recognize the further parafermion psi 2, which act first. And then the parafermion number one, but which has been dressed by all these strings around here, okay? And what it does, as we said, this is a closed contour with a spin inserted, so it will rotate the spins. And here we will have the product of, because we go, there is a direction, we conjugate G1 by G2. For I1. So you see that, that's what we call a commutation relation. Okay, we view it as we order the things, so we define ordering of observable. And that's a commutation relation. If it was Z2, it would be just phase. Z-end will be just phase. If it would be Z2, G minus 1. Group is abelian, so it doesn't mention anything. If it was Z2, it would be just plus or minus 1, this one. Okay? So it will correspond to fermions. So that's called Breding relation. And this answers the question why they are called parafermions, because it satisfies relations which are more complicated than just a boson or fermion commutation relation. Okay.
So again, in the case of plus or minus one spin, then everything breaks down to plus or minus one.
Yeah, exactly.
How could that give so many information?
I will tell you because of that. For example, you can reconstruct completely the operator from that commutation relation. And because you are breeding something, actually you. So you see, when you breed something, you are permuting position 1 and 2. So you will get a representation of the breeding groups. And that's what we call Young-Baxter equation, which are key ingredients for integrable model. But here we get it as a compatibility for the breeding relation. So we have a representation of the Breit groups, so the solution of Young-Baxter equation. Because what we do here, we start with V1. Which one was first? Two. So we have V2, some elements which belong to the representation space of 2, G2. We have V1. So V are a vector in the vector in the vector space associated to the representation R1, and V2 a vector in representation space associated to R2. And what we do is that we exchange the two. This one becomes R of G2, R1 of G2 acting on V1, G1, G2, G1 minus 1, and this one becomes is left invariant. Okay? So that's what we define, and we define on this object. If you want, this is a group algebra, and that's a vector. Yes, Jörg? And then we can do with 3 points. So we have 3, 2, 1. We can try to braid all of them. Okay? Then we will have braid everything. And what you can check is this is the same thing as braiding first the 2, 1, and then braiding the rest, and braiding again the 2. Okay? It is.
So in your brain at the top there, is it G1?
You should decide whether you want to have over or under cross.
Yes. I was careful here, but not here. So here you have to be careful. So this one is always above. And then I have to be careful. You have to decide, but here I am careful, here I will. So then you have this relation, and that's the Young-Baxter equation.
Excuse me. In your braiding at the top there, does it say G1, G2, G1 inverse?
Yes.
G2, or is it not supposed to be G2?
Ah, okay, yeah. G1, G2, yeah. I have a tiny problem, I am dyslexic, so I mix the letters and numbers. Okay, so so I did the first part. Then there's 5 minutes left, so I can stop. So probably I can explain. So what I want to say that, so maybe I will discuss why you get so much information for Ising. And then what I maybe that's why they asked me to talk, that to discuss more about quantum group symmetry. So here I discuss consequence of invariance under a group or Lie algebra. The group on Lie algebra can be deformed. And then if you assume, and that's called quantum group, and then if you assume that you have an invariant under this deformed structure, then you have an analog of the Noether current, so you have current, which are conserved, but they are non-local, okay? And this, so that was the construction we did with Giovanni Felder in the 19th, showing that every time you have a quantum group symmetry, which occurs in any integrable system, you will have infinite family, which can be infinite if the group is big enough, of conserved, non-local conserved current. And then if you do that for the six vectors models, which reduce to the ON model, you produce all these parafermion, spin-off parafermion, and the reduction was proved by Eklef and Weston. And then you can also reverse the logic that asks whether you have, in which case you have a conserved current, which is called sometimes holomorphic parafermion, but they are actually conserved currents, in the sense that you have contour integral vanishes. Then this forces the Boltzmann weight to satisfy the Young-Baxter equation. And that's a posteriori was it. So that's what Cardi did. He reversed the logic and asked when, under which condition on the Boltzmann weight you have a parafermionic current. And the fact that he imposed this condition imposed that you have the Young-Baxter equation, so you have an integrable system, is just the fact that if you impose that the if you impose existence of conserved current, you are imposing a symmetry. If it's non-local, this symmetry has to be a quantum group. And if it's a quantum group, then you know that to be symmetry, it has to intertwine the Boltzmann weight, the air matrix associated to the Boltzmann weight, and so it has to be an integrable system. So that was the third part, a bit difficult to explain in 2 minutes. Then I would just...
Oh, excuse me, this conserved current is supposed at the very beginning to be an element of the quantum group, or...?
Yeah, as the universal element of the universal enveloping algebra of the quantum algebra. Okay, then I can explain in private if you want. But the construction is more or less the same. Once you understand well the canon of Ceva construction, then to move to the quantum group construction is simple. So maybe what I want to explain is why a few consequences of the parafermionic construction, or what you can think is a consequence of that. So so that was two echoes in field theory. So maybe I start with the massive case and then on massive field theory. So what we call massive is that it is away from criticality. So if you are at criticality, you have macroscopic object, like Hugo says, so then you can take the continuum limit. If you are close to criticality, you can still take the continuum limit because you have macroscopic object, but you have to scale the way you approach criticality in the same way as you scale the lattice. So assume that we are in this scaling regime. Then you have a field theory. And so why you can this give information is that there is two remarks. So the first remark, which is general, which is these Brennig relations are purely topological. So they're independent on the fact that you are at criticality or away. So they are invariant. In physics, we will say they are invariant on the renormalization group. They are also they apply also away from criticality. So Brennig relation are still valid, at and away from criticality. And then the remark two, which is true for Ising. So for Ising, you have G is SU2. And so we take the only note, so there is a spin observable, which I will call sigma of x spins. You have the disorder operators, x, disorder. And then you have what I call the parafermion, which is now a fermion, okay? Just for when G is a non-trivial element in Z2, and R is a non-trivial representation in Z2. Okay? Parafem. And this satisfies some relations that psi of Y, sigma of X, no, mu of 0, psi of x will be the sine of x, psi of x, mu of 0. Because why they have this relation is because, well, it's by construction. Is it this one I want to? Maybe it's sigma. Sigma is better. Okay. So for example, if x is bigger than, so maybe it's, so if my parafermion is here, so if it, this is x for the parafermion, and that's 0, they commute, there is no obstruction, so it should be minus sigma x. Okay, if x is negative, so that doesn't matter. If x is bigger, then I have an obstruction, because I have the spin here, 0, and the string here, x, and then I have an obstruction. Okay. So now I am physics, so I have sigma here, so I can just multiply by the inverse. Okay? But these observables satisfy anti-commutation relation. Okay. So this means that sigma at 0 is an automorphism of the commutation relation of the fermions. Okay. So that means sigma of zero. What we in physics we call it Bogolubov transformation, but here it belongs to GL infinity. And you can construct it completely from the fact that it induces automorphism. So it will be it, then there is an explicit expression of it's an element of it's a group which element of the group which preserves the commutation relation. It's a specific element which is specified by this how it transforms the fermions. Okay, so then you construct it completely, and then you know the correction function. And that's what is called then the expectation value of this object are an example of tau function, and then the Kyoto School generalize it and define what is the tau function or orbit of this group. So that's different. The tau function emerged from the study of the Ising model, and one of the basic points was this one, that you preserve that sigma is generated, is automorphism of the commutation relation. Isomodromy deformation, which is another way to obtain Ising correction function from the fact that when you deform, when you change the temperature, you preserve the commutation relation, which means that you preserve the monodromy of the correction function. So that was one of the consequences. So the last consequence is I want to discuss is vertex operators. So as it was said this morning, if you look at loop model at n equal 2, critical point correspond what is a special, and it corresponds what we call to free boson in a critical temperature. And when you have free bosons, you can construct vertex operators following Mandel's sum. This construction originated from string theory, but it's a direct application of this one. So, so CFT construction. So Mandel's sum. So you consider a boson, so it's a field, which is x and t. T for me is the direction which is go up. When you do field theory, classical or not, you have a conjugated momentum, which is a which satisfies canonical commutation relation. And then what Mandelson defined is something which depends on alpha, x and t, and which is plus minus, maybe it's plus minus, e alpha integral from minus infinity to x of pi dy times exponential of I alpha phi of x. So again, this is an object which is infinite strings with a spin that's analog of the spin observable, local one, and that's the infinite strings. And the group here is U1. So that's the object which was introduced by Mandelson. They satisfy Breding relation, so you also by because if you try to compute the commutation relation, you will find the same Breding relation, some Breding relation because of this commutation relation. Maybe there is an I here. And if you look at if this is a massless field, you will see that this is analog actually to if it's a free boson, that corresponds to a special conformal field theory. Well, that's one of the examples of vertex operators in field theory, which are holomorphic. So if I wrote something like x plus it, Jörg will not be happy. But so this, in the massless theory, so in CFT, this will become vertex operators which are holomorphic. And in general, vertex operators, so if you look at correlation function of such object, because these satisfy commutation relation, these will have monodromy property. Okay, you can look at when you turn the, you look at the endpoint correlation function, it will be on the sphere or some Riemann surfaces with n puncture, and you can try to see what happens when you move the point around the on this puncture on the surface. You will get phases, and the monodromy property reflects the Breding relation of the operators. And more generally, you can look at breeding relation of vertex operators intertwining conformal field theories, it will satisfy many properties. For example, Dünnfeld did many things on that. All these breeding properties are, in a way, a formulation of the breeding relation of the parafilm. So all vertex operators in conformal field theory can be viewed as vertex operators for some group, as to some group or quantum group symmetry. Okay? So that was the notion of vertex operator algebra, monotropy property, which are consequences of this parafermionic construction. Okay, so I have been long enough, I think. I will stop here. I had a
I apologize, but I want to return to this question, why the Eisen model is so special. So if I start with something else, right, then it looks like I have a representation not of commutational relations of fermions, but those of parafermions, right? Mm-hmm. So what's I'm not familiar with that, but what's the problem? They're not well studied, they're just wild or what?
First, on the lattice, as it was said, you can define different parafermions depending where you put the strings. And that's how you will define. So you will introduce different set observable, and which at the critical point will become the two components of the massless fermion. Okay? Otherwise, you don't have them. So that's one special property. And then, the rising model is also particular because it's parafermionic observable. If you look at, so if on the lattice, it satisfies linear equation of motion. It means that if you look.
No, this I know, but somehow your argument was, I mean, it looked like algebraic, right?
Yeah,
I mean, when you gave this argument, it was nothing said about these linear equations. It looked much more abstract.
Yeah, so maybe it's why you can, maybe there is hope to do something. So in practice, here you have commutation relation, and you know on which space you have. So this satisfies some commutation relation, which means you have some algebra, and you know on which space you can represent this algebra. And then you have an automorphism on this algebra automorphism on that space, and you know how to represent this automorphism. That's, you don't know for the n parafermion, you will not know how to do that. Okay? So that's what is special about.
It's an equation of motions. It's true in much bigger generality, right? That there are some linear equations for products of spins and disorders.
Yeah. So they don't. In Ising models, the equation of motion closes on a finite set of objects, which has a parafermion. For the Zn models, they don't. When you, for example, if you look at these currents, they don't close. But nevertheless, for example, that was one question I wanted to ask. So you have, in general, and for the ON model, you know that you have it, you have a series of infinite set of conserved quantities. And from another work done by the Kyoto School, by Jimbo and Miwa in the 90s also. So Jimbo and Miwa. So they use this quantum symmetry. So that was two parallel work. But they were able to use a quantum symmetry, which is an infinite dimensional quantum symmetry in the six vertex model, to compute a correction function in some regime. So they mean even if equation of motion do not close, you know enough about the representation theory to compute a correction function. So I think that's one open problem for the probabilists, is to do the parallel construction in probabilistic term of what Jimbo Miwa did.
Not to take too much delay, we'll save further questions for the break and thank Denis again.